Hey there, episode 170. We have a commercial real estate broker and consultant, Terry Yonker, on the show today with experience in working with international investors. Great interview for overseas listeners to get some insight of investing in the U.S. All that and more coming up.
Welcome to the Wealth Through Real Estate Investing Podcast, your source for real-world strategies focused on creating long-term wealth, cash flow, and financial freedom through real estate. Through guidance, tips, and stories of highly successful real estate investors and thought leaders, we provide you the tools to succeed and to reach the lifestyle you always wanted. And now, your host, Dwaine Clarke.
Hello and welcome to the Wealth Through Real Estate Investing Show. This is your host, Dwaine Clarke, and today we have Terry Yonker. Terry is the founder of Buckeye Realty in Orlando, Florida. Buckeye Realty is a commercial real estate brokerage dedicated to helping clients around the world build wealth and financial freedom through real estate and investments in the U.S. Terry, thank you so much for joining us on the show, and how are you doing, my friend?
Great, great. Thanks for having me, Dwaine. Look forward to it.
Absolutely. Yeah, this is one topic that we always kind of, we have a lot of international listeners as well as we continue to grow the show. And I know that we spoke a couple months ago, I believe, just kind of talking about your specialty and things that you help out. I know we're kind of in a similar fields of investment brokerages and dealing with all different types of investors. And I had my share of international investors, but love to kind of pick your brain on how well that is and kind of learn more about that process. But before we kick things off, for people who are not familiar with your background, would you mind talk about how you got started in real estate and what your current focus is on?
Yeah, sure. I'm originally from Youngstown, Ohio, hence the Buckeye Realty moniker. I just hope their trademark attorneys don't come after me, although we're riding high. I don't know when this is coming on. We'll see if they win the national championship coming up. But yeah, just a training. I have my MBA in finance from Ohio State and undergrad from Villanova. And so our big challenge when we moved to a smaller town, my wife and I moved to a small town in Southwest Florida called Punta Gorda near Fort Myers and lived there for 14 years. And the challenge was, how can you make the kind of income that you want to make without being in a major city with a major financial hub? And so again, real estate was an obvious avenue, a lot of money getting traded, a lot of, even in smaller towns, a lot of deal flow. So that was how we got into it. And then, you know, just gravitate toward what you know and what you like, as many of your listeners, or maybe you have, you know, once you start getting that background and see what floats your boat and tickles your fancy. And we moved into commercial very quickly. I mean, I sold a lot of houses, but as we got into commercial, and then my international background, I mean, I've lived in a handful of countries and speak four languages and just really love digging in with helping foreign people as a way to pay them back, because those of us who have lived overseas know what it's like to be on the opposite side, you know, where you're in another country and maybe don't speak that language, you don't know the ways, and you're kind of like a helpless child in some respects, you know, and these people mm-hmm. help you, and there's no way you can pay them back when you're there, you know? So I kind of made a vow that, you know, when I got back to America, I would reciprocate, not directly with those people, because it's almost impossible, but when similar people from these countries would come, I would do to them what they did to me in those countries. And so that's a long-winded way on how you come from like small town into real estate, into gravitating. And now we're here in Orlando and just basically up in the game into bigger markets and bigger things.
Absolutely. And as far as kind of like your kind of pulse to the market, I know you're talking to a lot of international investors. What are their kind of their appetite? What are they kind of looking for? And are you also educating them on kind of what's, you know, what's kind of hot, what's, you know, what's available, things that are good to invest in? But what are you hearing from their perspective as far as what they're looking for? I know different countries have different kind of investment structures. I talked to, you know, a bunch of different international investors, and it's like, it's impossible to get these types of returns you guys are doing and all that stuff. But what are you hearing on the ground?
Yeah, you know, and I could speak specifically to Orlando here. You know, we get a lot of investments from South America, and a lot of that is just capital exiting, you know? Mm-hmm. So like with the smaller returns, a lot of times you'll look at an investment with a lot of investment from, you know, Venezuela, especially with what's going on with them, Argentina, Mexico, and the return seems so small, but there's a capital preservation aspect of it, you know, where they're just getting capital out and buying, say, vacation homes here in Orlando and Disney, mm-hmm. or these multifamily, you know, units that can be either multifamily or vacation rentals. We specifically look at commercial commercial properties. And, you know, now I can't speak with knowledge of this, but as we get into commercial notes, because we've gotten our hands on a couple of those deals where we actually trade the note. And so I'm not going to by no means claim to be an expert on that yet. Maybe we talk in a couple of years, we will, but that's one where, you know, boy, it's liquid. It's easier to manage. It's easier, a little bit easier to define, you know, returns. And so we're really excited about that. But yeah, here in general, again, capital preservation on assets and the commercial buildings here are still, you know, still top notch for them, because that's when you get into notes too, it's a little more abstract, you know, like they like to be able to come here. And with the vacation homes that they invest in, the ones I mentioned before, they like it because, well, before the coronavirus restrictions, of course, they could actually come, you know, go to Disney World, see their place and sit in it, touch, feel. And that was a rewarding part of it. So there's that interesting mix that if you weren't exposed to it, you may not have put too much value in it, you know, but sometimes people from these countries where things get seized, I mean, it's just flat out, you know, they can, as we've seen in Venezuela, for example, you know, but there's an example that, you know, oh, they can touch it, feel it, show their friends. And so that has value.
Absolutely. And then what are you seeing as far as kind of like challenges for international investors investing here? I know, like I talked to my colleagues in Canada, and we always having that debate back and forth, and they kind of talking about, like, you know, taxing structures and entity structures and things like that. Can you talk about kind of some of the challenges that you see for international investors investing in the US?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the transparency here is at a level that they're not accustomed to, and in general. And that's something that, again, as Americans, I feel like we don't appreciate enough until you go to those places. As I mentioned, they can just seize properties. Or I always give that example of when we went to Argentina in 2002, I think, and they were reeling from what was called a corralito. And again, our Argentinian friends can correct me on the details, but it was basically where they said, hey, you can keep this much, anything over that, the government takes, and that's it. That's it. There's no recourse. There's nobody to complain to. Like, that was it. And it was appalling. And then I came back and kissed the ground. And so, like, these types of issues that maybe you don't think of with that when you're not working with foreigners, it comes into play with them. And so they're very cognizant of safety, of taxes, of structures. And, you know, something as simple as an LLC with a very clean operating agreement where they can operate as Americans. So, you know, some of the investors that we've come across, they've already invested in America personally under their name, which is a mistake, because then it brings in what's called FIRPTA, where the, you know, government withholds money automatically, and all these issues. So we try to get them into a very simple LLC, but then that also has to have a third party, a third country that buys the LLC for them that they bounce through, because again, Uncle Sam, they like to grab foreigners' money, especially. It's almost like with Regulation S, you know, offerings and things. I'm not going to talk about that. I'm not an SEC attorney by any means, but the general gist is, you know, with foreigners, it's buyer beware. Americans, like, their laws to protect us. And so, you know, with that structure, with the LLC, if you have the third party country where then that can invest in the LLC and then they are wherever they are, then you can avoid a lot of tax implications by having that structure. So it seems kind of convoluted, right? Like, why can't you just, one, buy as a foreigner? I'm Joe Smith foreigner. That's the worst. And then the second is the individual LLC, because there are some limits on probate, especially. And then the best structure is just more convoluted, you know, two country jump, but that protects you from like if there's a death and the limits on what they can take. So yeah, that's the structure we like to use with our foreigners.
And as far as kind of like the timing, is it, I know, like, if we here in America, we see a property, we can make an offer and then pretty much close like 30, 60 days. Is it typically for international investors? Is it like a longer lag time? And then, and if there is, should they be in the process here early, setting up like entity structures, you know, consulting with attorneys, you know, tax accountants and things like that in order to start making offers? Because in some instances, timing is crucial for some certain type of deals.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. And again, we talk ideal world and kind of what really happens. I mean, in a perfect world, of course, you set up a structure, you get it funded, you go through a currency exchange company to get their local currency into US dollars, get into the account. And in some instances, you know, I've even, when I'm on their company accounts, I have signing authority or power of attorney, and, you know, you can get that deep. So yeah, in a perfect world, all that set up, and then you offer just like you're an American, you know, if it's foreign company LLC based out of Orlando, Florida, and I have signing authority, then you're in business, of course, the perfect world. But yeah, if you're setting that up, absolutely, those steps have to happen ahead of time. And, you know, especially the wiring and the money. And one of the issues that are very relevant now is the notaries for overseas countries, because again, when you're notarizing documents, if you're selling either selling property on your own or giving me like authority, you have to notarize a document at the embassy,
right?
Or have a foreign notary do it. Well, in countries like France or some of them, they're just shut down. The embassy is closed and the notaries are afraid to come out and do work to some extent. So that's been an obstacle that we've had, where we've had deals waiting, and just to get the movement, something simple as a notary that you and I might not think twice about, we just go down to the bank and get, you know, a notary, really becomes an issue with that. So these are the kind of obstacles that you're mentioning, what takes more time. And that's typically it, getting them to trust every step of it, because again, we're on the scale of transparency and trustworthiness, the United States in general, as much as we, you know, like to complain, we're still pretty good. And it takes a while for them to have that faith or as much trust as we do in our structures and what's in place.
Absolutely. And as far as kind of like investment vehicles, what do you think is more ideal? I understand like they do all of the work to kind of, you know, the notaries and dealing with the embassies and things like that until they're, you know, capable and able to invest in the U.S. Are you seeing a lot, and are you seeing stuff, especially you dealing with them as far as kind of investing in funds and then funds investing into commercial real estate? Or are you seeing a lot more kind of direct transactions where investor sees, I like this property, I'm just going to invest in it? And which ones is more kind of, you know, that you're seeing more of, you know, coming more circle?
Yeah, you know, we're seeing more of the investment of the individual through the, you know, through the entity, because they want to kind of own it, you know. And but as I just described, it has all of those implications to where I'm signing on documents or getting notaries and all those things. So to answer your question, they like to own it. There's a pride of ownership to some extent. If you have even a condo or a property in Miami Beach, you know, they're like, this is mine. And sometimes they'll come over just to touch it and say, this is mine. So we see that we're trying to move as much as we can, get them comfortable with the fund syndication model, just because it's so much easier to operate. And then we can operate as managers. But again, especially, you know, as a limited partner, it's not the same cachet, you know, if you're as investing in where you go to Miami and this is my, you know, fourplex, or this is my whatever I have. So to answer your question, you know, it is more, but we see anyway in our world. I mean, maybe if you interview some of the bank financers, you know, they work only in funds and foreign funds. But from our perspective, we're seeing a lot of individual guys that we're trying to move to the more efficient fund model. And as I mentioned earlier, even getting away from hard assets into the paper assets of commercial notes, which is, you know, we have relationships now over a decade. And as we meet with these guys and talk, and once they trust you, you know, and you've gone through the battles of, you know, getting them in and out of assets or something they stumbled into that was suboptimal, to say the least. And you know, there's a story about a Detroit, our investors that bought a handful of houses in Detroit, and we went up there and to look at the investments. And yeah, that was interesting. I'm an Ohio State grad, so I have a bias against Michigan anyway. It's just in our blood. But, you know, we started unwinding them around the country from different asset classes. And so getting into something that's paper and a little more liquid, a little more, you know, clean, is exciting in that new structure.
Yeah, it's definitely us in learning more and more about it. And especially as we kind of get more listeners and more investors that kind of come into our world, and we're trying to like educate them. So I'm glad that you're able to come on and at least shed some more light. And pretty sure you can go on this topic for a very long time on the legal and the tax structure and all that different type of stuff. And we'll definitely be, you know, putting now for like another specific topic for an interview. But to learn more about you, I know we had talked a couple weeks ago. It was great getting to know you and kind of your background. But for the people who are not familiar with you, can you talk about kind of like your typical work day, and do you have any special morning routines?
You know, I have, I do. I have an 8-year-old daughter, so she gets up and cranking at 6:30 and gets jumping. So my routine to take a meditation routine and not to get too foo-foo-y, but you know, I'll get up, do my meditation routine. I have a little mini Ashtanga practice that I do. And then my daughter gets up and she's a dancer. So I do a little dance routine. So like she likes to teach me to dance. So I used to be able to do that at 8 o'clock in the morning. Now I push it all ahead of time. So, but what I find is that physical, for me anyway, the physical part, if I skip that, I can notice during the day, you know, that's immediate feedback. So my routine to set up a successful day is to have the physical part, the meditation, the physical part, the time with my daughter, and then I can go off with a clear conscience. Because again, if I don't see her in the morning, it weighs on me during the day. So those specific things, the physical, the meditation, the physical, and then seeing her, that sets the day. So I, you know, I wish it could be more out of the, have these checklists and everything, but for me, the physical and touching is an important routine for me.
I like that a lot. Cause then actually the last like four interviews is that every guest said the exact same thing about the power of meditation and clearing the mind,
right?
and for like extreme focus and things. It's just like kind of just a lot of successful people do that. And like, I just started getting back into and adopting that in. And cause we normally get up like around 4 and I just have this 25-minute wow. period. I'm just doing my meditation. And like you had said, you notice a difference, you know, a lot. So yeah. It's these are little things that, you know, people kind of take for granted, they don't do. And like I said, but it definitely helps out a lot. So I appreciate you sharing that again. And as far as kind of you working with your team and, or maybe yourself, is there any, you know, productivity tools that you use that helps you make you more productive during the day?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, we actually teach a course on virtual assistants for real estates. Cause again, when you discover something, you know how it's like, wow, this is the greatest thing ever. I got to share it with the world. Kind of like you are with what you're doing. Mm-hmm. We had a similar epiphany with virtual assistants. I actually went to the Philippines and met all my guys. So what a resource, you know, having outsourced VAs. So, but the trick is, as you mentioned, the tools, like how can you coordinate? And, you know, I think I've chased every shiny object to try to optimize this productivity. And I think what really helps is if you can identify how you like to work. So I'm a visual person. I like to see kind of laid out, or I kind of get frozen unless I see where I'm going. So there's a product called Mindomo, and what it is, it's mind mapping, if you're familiar with it. Mm-hmm. And then it can also flip to a Gantt chart. So like your analytical part gets fed, and then you can also see the visual. Mm-hmm. And then you go back and forth, and I have my virtual assistants tie into this. So we're on the same page.
Like that.
And then the CRM that I have moved from, again, I use a traditional real estate one typically called Wise Agent CRM, but again, with feeding my visual need, is the one we use now, is called Pipe Drive. And again, you've heard of that one.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Boy, when you talk about moving that deal, it gives you a little high, you know, like a little shot of dopamine almost, like, oh, I moved it from this space to this space. And then the one. And they play on that too. They know the psychology, because when you hit one and all the things go up. So I find just by default, and this is for me, maybe somebody else is better with a spreadsheet, but boy, when I can have visual, things move along, and then our Mindomo will change colors based on when the project is completed. And so just seeing the colors move across my Mindomo, or seeing the Pipe Drive move across. And then they all have access to that from the Philippines. And, they log in with us, and you know, we can all be on the same page.
I like that a lot. Yeah, it's definitely I have two virtual assistants, and it's just like transform my business. It's just like, you know, little task, and like we got a lot of different systems, so we're definitely resonating as on the same things as there. And I always end this with all of our interviews, and it's always a very important question of gratitude. So what can you say that you're most grateful for?
Well, you know, I'm of course, this is kind of normal probably, I think, but I'm most grateful probably for my wife, and not just my wife, but for everything she is, but because she, you know, she has a little travel bug, and she has, when I get tied up into the grind, and she's there, she's the, not the opposite of me, but she's the other part of me. So she's saying, hey, when are we going to go, let's make this happen. So we're going to Austin, Texas for a month and just renting a place and working remotely there.
Nice.
And then after that, we're going to Santa Fe and working there for a month, and then we're going to Boulder, Colorado, and we're making a tour right now. That would never happen.
Yeah,
I'd be in my grind, right? And that's what I like to do, and that's what I like my daughter to experience. And you know, we're just putting it together because we're getting ready to pack up and leave here in a couple weeks. And so it reminds me of how grateful I am, because if that piece wasn't there, I'd probably be grinding here, when that's really my my being, what I like to do and what I want my daughter to experience as we go. Mm-hmm. So we're looking forward to Austin. And yeah, I'm grateful for her because I would have probably kicked it down the road and been too busy and all those things if it wasn't for her driving it. So I look forward to being out there.
Awesome. Yeah, yeah, definitely got to keep in touch and learn and see how those trips are going. So yeah, I really appreciate you sharing that. And then, and finally, how do we get in contact with you?
Well, everything's on BuckeyeRealty.com, of course, and I made a subpage, so BuckeyeRealty.com/WTRE, and we'll put a link up to your page, and we'll talk about some of the subjects there where just your listeners can come on, and we can chat on there specifically about what we're covering here, and just reach out on your page, you know, on the Dwaine page on our website. So that'd be a great place.
Yeah, we'll make sure to have all that stuff in the show notes, and we'll be sending out to our social media network and our newsletter and stuff like that, so people are very aware of that. Terry, it was a pleasure to speak with you. Definitely gonna have you back on the show again, talk about additional topics, you know, all, you know, international investments, commercial real estate in Florida. I really appreciate it. Happy New Year, best to you and the family, and look forward to connecting with you again soon.
Likewise. Thanks, Dwaine. Thanks for having me.
All right, take care, my friend. Hey there, this is Dwaine Clarke, your host of the Wealth Through Real Estate Investing Show. I want to thank you again for tuning in and hope you're enjoying this valuable content. While I got you for a quick minute, I wanted to send you an invitation to join our growing investor community. It's called the Passive Investors Club. It's a group of like-minded individuals like you who are seeking financial freedom and to build true wealth through passive investing in commercial real estate. We take a totally different approach to investing that is opposite, that is pushed by the financial advisors and what we see in the mainstream media. We like to invest in real assets that we can touch and understand and that are not subject to the wild swings of the financial markets. We don't want to be part of the herd who pursues the traditional route, leaving our financial future to Wall Street. So if you're interested in joining our group and to share in resources and opportunities, then go to passiveinvestorsclub.com/join. Joining the club is completely free and there's no obligation. And all our members receive our free Passive Investors course along with tons of resources and content. So again, passiveinvestorsclub.com/join.